Hi, this is EnX04, and today I'll show you a mob farm that's designed to be built extremely fast in survival, and easy to upgrade. That way you can start with a perfectly respectable basic farm like this one, which can be built in just 12 minutes, and then gradually improve on it so that it looks like this one, which looks huge but actually only takes an hour to make, and gives you a whopping 18,000 drops per hour from a single tower. Much of the design uses scaffolding as the actual building material in the farm. Not only is scaffolding easy and fast to place as a block, it actually has a surprising number of other properties that make it pretty much the perfect material for mob farm building. The only problem with scaffolding is that it's crafted from bamboo, which, despite being easy to farm and grows crazy fast, can be challenging to obtain in early game, but I'll offer some tips in the video description on how to find it. You might also have limited supplies of string to make scaffolding, but if you have enough to make just a few spawning pads in the farm, you'll produce more string from spider drops to let you expand on your build. With this in mind, if you'd like to skip straight to the build tutorial, just go to the time displayed on the screen. Otherwise, you can hang around for a few minutes to hear about the design of this farm and how it takes advantage of scaffolding in many interesting ways. The general design of the farm should look very familiar to experienced players. Check out some of the links in the description for some of the great contributions by other YouTubers. The farm is basically a stack of spawning pads that gets flushed with water using a cascading signal that's passed through dispensers and observers. In this farm, we use scaffolding as the spawning surface, which is kind of interesting because it actually permits spawning despite being transparent. And it has the added feature that mobs don't pathfind to scaffolding, which means that mobs don't fight the flow of water that's pushing them off the platforms. They just passively let themselves get pushed off, which is the same behavior as what you would see using top slabs as the building material. And this is the reason why top slabs are normally used instead of solid blocks for spawning platforms. You probably already know that scaffolding is extremely easy to place, and that it can overhang by 6 blocks, but the overhang is determined by taxicab distance, which means that scaffolding is suspended in a diamond shape that matches the way that water spreads on a flat surface, which is also by taxicab distance. And the nice thing is that if you add too many scaffolding blocks, the extra ones just fall off. This means that you don't have to be precise with placing scaffolding, since it sort of has a built-in error correction mechanism. You can even use a macro to mash right-click for you to make things even easier, but if you do this, just double-check to make sure that this is allowed if you play on a server. In most other mob farm designs, the redstone signal propagates downwards from a clock on the roof, but this design puts the clock at the bottom, and it propagates the signal upward instead. One advantage of this design is that it makes the farm easier to expand, since you don't need to move the clock each time that you add more spawning pads. And it turns out that transmitting the clock signal upwards makes it easier to build the spawning pads as well, because the observers and dispensers are naturally oriented in the convenient direction for the build. This way, when you finish building a spawning pad, you can just move on to the next one above, and you really don't need to go up and down between platforms, unless you've made a mistake somewhere. One of the features of scaffolding that enables an upward cascade of dispenser and observer signals is the fact that scaffolding can be waterlogged. Normally, when water is switched off at the dispenser, the observer detects the missing water and sends a pulse. But the flowing water in the surrounding spaces then flows back into the empty spot and triggers the observer a second time. And then the flowing water eventually dissipates and triggers the observer a third time. These multiple pulses are cascaded to the next platform, which then only makes the problem worse as the issue continues to propagate to additional platforms. Scaffolding prevents water from flowing back so that only a single pulse is sent to the next platform, which completely fixes the issue. The clock for the farm uses scaffolding to send its signal up to the spawning pads. This works because each piece of scaffolding keeps track of how much it's overhanging, and flipping the trapdoor changes this property for every piece of scaffolding in the pillar. In this position, scaffolding is not overhanging at all since it's resting directly on top of a trapdoor, but now the entire pillar is overhanging by 1, and this change in state is detected by the observer on the bottom spawning pad. This farm design completely skips a mob coalescing pool, and instead uses hopper minecarts to collect the drops from a somewhat large area. This arrangement of rails collects about 92-93% of drops from the farm, which is surprisingly efficient, given how simple it is. I use 2 hopper minecarts in a loop because they will almost always restart each other in case something gets in the way, which is actually pretty rare. The hopper minecarts on the rails are unloaded using other hopper minecarts that are embedded in the ground. Alright, let's get to building. Start by setting torches to light up some low flat ground, A desert biome, close to the ocean, would be a good choice if you want to reduce the amount of rotten flesh from the farm. Set down a solid block with a trapdoor on the side. This trapdoor marks the center of the farm. About 16 blocks away, set down a landing pad of water that you'll use later on to get down safely. Put exactly 28 blocks of scaffolding into one of your hotbar slots, and then place the scaffolding on the solid block and trapdoor, and then add a pillar of scaffolding on top of the trapdoor until you run out. At the top of the pillar, set down an observer and place trapdoors on each side, and then add the dispenser. Crouch down and set scaffolding on each trapdoor, and then extend the scaffolding out by an additional 6 blocks. Fill out the platform with scaffolding into the diamond shape, and add a bucket of water to the dispenser. Crouch down and add scaffolding on top of the dispenser, add an observer, and then continue building the next spawning platform the exact same way. You can have up to 25 platforms before they start to encroach on your AFK spot. After your last platform is set, you'll need to add a roof. If you think that you'll add more spawning pads later, just build a temporary roof with top slabs. This roof is easy to set up and will let your farm work at 60% capacity at nighttime when it's dark. Go out from the center by 10 blocks in each direction and fill in the diamond. Add 4 torches located 4 blocks away from the center to prevent mobs from appearing on the roof. When it comes time to expand your farm, convert this roof to a spawning platform by trimming it down so that the diamond shape goes out only 7 blocks from the center. Break the center of the roof and scaffolding below it to add the observer, dispenser, water bucket, and scaffolding, and you're ready to continue adding more spawning platforms, just like before. When you're ready for a full-sized roof that completely darkens the spawning pads, be sure to use bottom slabs, not top slabs. Go out 21 blocks from the center and fill in the diamond shape. When you're done with the roof, jump down to the water landing pad that you set earlier and flip the trapdoor at the center of the farm. Look up to make sure that you don't see a waterfall coming down at you. If you do, you're probably missing a scaffolding block from one of the pads. Go back up to repair. Otherwise, you're safe to build the clock, which is just 13 repeaters set to full delay, a comparator set to subtract mode, a lever, and some redstone dust. For the collection system, go out 9 blocks from the trapdoor in each direction and set down a powered rail and lever next to it to turn it on. Now make a ring of rails around the farm, alternating between one straight rail and one curved rail until all the pieces are connected. For the hopper unloading system, dig a trench 5 blocks long and 2 blocks deep, starting at one of the curved rails. Add a chest at the end and feed 4 hoppers into it. Cover the hopper next to the chest and float some temporary blocks over the other 3 hoppers. Set rails and hopper minecarts on the first and third hoppers and break the temporary blocks so that the hopper minecarts fall straight down. Do the same for the middle and then use a piston and lever as shown to cover the hopper minecarts in the ground. Restore the rails to complete the installation of this unloader. Each unloader like this can handle about 7,000 drops per hour. You might need to add a second or third unloader to the system depending on how productive your farm is. To get your collection system working, make sure that all the powered rails are turned on, and then add 2 hopper minecarts and give them a gentle push to get them going. Finally, we need to build an elevator to the AFK spot, which is at an altitude 127 blocks higher than the ground where the rails are located. Put 64 and 63 scaffolding into your hotbar, and build up until you run out, preferably just past the roofline of the mob farm, in case you need to access it later. At the top of the pillar, set a torch to prevent spawning and bridge out until you're over the center of the farm, and set some cover overhead if you need protection from phantoms. You can upgrade this elevator to a bubble column using a neat trick that I'll show in the remainder of this video. Well, that's it for now. I hope you found this video helpful and gets you going on a mob farm that fits whatever your needs may be. As a reminder, please check out the video description for more information, as I'll have some additional tips and perhaps some corrections to make. Thanks for watching.